Wolf Tones by JJ Marsh, read by Paul Panting for Saga Egmont. To Julie Lewis and her colleagues, for the work they do. Chapter 1. His concentration faded with the light. The soft stroke of the low notes created a hollow mid-air tone, not a warm vibration in his chest, and the high voice played out in short mechanical bursts. He was missing that forward movement. He couldn't make the instrument sing or connect with the piece. He was supposed to be rehearsing the saraband of Bach's Suite No. 5, but he was unable to focus. Part of the problem was the noise from the apartment upstairs, small feet scampering across wooden floors. The greater issue was his own sense of failure, the depressing winter evening, and the conviction he was wasting his time. To stop himself staring at the lights in the opposite building, or watching people board buses in the street below, he closed the curtains. His gaze fell on the oil painting above the boarded-up fireplace, the single object of beauty in this dismal set of rooms. The only piece they had managed to rescue from the von Rosenheim estate. A grey mare with a chestnut foal caught in a ray of sunlight. The foal's coat gleamed like copper, and the spring grass of the meadow suggested prosperity and peace. That picture represented hope. He sighed and picked up his bow once again. The call came just before 6. With some relief, he put his instrument aside and answered the telephone. They thanked him for his submission. Several members of the orchestra's string section remembered him performing at the Bartok World Competition. They were impressed. Rolf had earned himself an audition for next month, the chance to fill a tutti cello vacancy in the upcoming season, the opening chapter of a new life. He received the news with humility and expressed his astonishment, acknowledging the honour. He said he was surprised, shocked, in fact. It was what they expected to hear. Of course, they warned him not to get his hopes up. It was an audition, nothing more, and he was one of over 30 applicants. Rolf assured them he understood, and that he would take this in his stride. In truth, that was an understatement. He could barely breathe as excitement and escape routes thundered through his mind like freight trains, whistling their potential. He pulled his attention back to the handset. He remembered to say thank you when they wished him luck, and ended the call. He paced the tiny apartment, seeing nothing of its faded grey walls and nondescript carpet, visualizing instead a carnival of colour in his head. In 3 weeks, his life could change forever. Our lives, he corrected himself. Should he call her and tell her, or wait till she got home? He would calm down, cook a celebratory meal, and tell her over a glass of wine. He couldn't wait to see her face, glowing in the knowledge her faith in him was validated. He grabbed his jacket and ran down 4 flights of stairs, so light on his feet he seemed to be flying. The stench of boiled cabbage and mold didn't touch him, because his mind was already sampling coffee and pastries at a riverside cafe. At the supermarket, he grabbed a packet of pork chops at 20% off and a bottle of Hungarian red. He had no idea whether it was any good. That was yet another area where her expertise exceeded his. But if I get the job, he corrected himself again, thinking positively, when I get the job, we'll drink wine every day. He broke into a jog on the return journey, for no other reason than an excess of energy. The sparse and cramped apartment, which usually depressed him as soon as he opened the front door, failed to bring him down today. He stood at the threshold, mentally transforming it into their new quarters. Instead of one room doing double duty as his study by day and living room in the evening, he would have a music room of his own, with French windows opening onto a lawn. Strains of Mendelssohn's String Quartet No. 6, played in a neighbour's garden, would float across the grass as wild birds added a natural accompaniment. Their kitchen would be the size of this whole apartment, an island in the centre where she would experiment with fresh ingredients she had bought at full price. They'd have a wine rack and expensive cookware and Turkish rugs and a group of young, talented friends round for dinner. He put the wine and chops on the small kitchen table under the window which served as their dining room and found an out-of-date packet of instant mashed potato in the cupboard. Even his limited culinary skills were up to chopping an onion and making a sauce for the meat. She would come home to a feast, at least by their standards. He put Le Comte d'Hoffmann on the stereo and hummed along with the baccarole as he cooked. This was his time to win. He knew it in his gut. He was hungry for success. There was a time when he considered this apartment a step up, but now he could see it for what it was, a step up for him and a long fall for her. Comparisons with her ancestral home were a waste of time, but he couldn't help thinking of those towers, the buttressed walls, the huge works of art, the grand piano, the stables, the sweeping gardens leading down to the lake. Now she was reduced to three parsimonious rooms they could barely afford on his orchestra pittance and her income as a music teacher. Her sense of humour had kept them going. She made him laugh by describing the apartment in real estate agent terms. "Beg a bargain in Bratislava. A bijou residence in an up-and-coming suburb with a view of three countries, and even if you can't quite see the Danube, you can smell the brewery." He'd join in, describing the rooms as if finding some joy in their failings. From the roof of their block you could see three countries. That much was true. To the northeast, the rest of Slovakia. That blue haze to the south was the border with Hungary, and a mere 20-minute journey to the west lay Austria, land of schnitzel, confectionery, and Mozart. Austria. Things were about to change. This was a new reality. He'd been invited to audition in Salzburg. That kind of opportunity comes once in a lifetime, and he would not let it get away. A sharp pain made him wince. Blood seeped from a cut on his index finger, contrasting with the white chopping board and the thinly sliced onion. Her voice rang in his ears, as clearly as if she were in the room. "Look out for your hands, Rolf. Treat them gently. They are your instruments, not the cello." He wrapped a tissue around his finger and focused on what he was doing. Making her a meal was an act of love. Her idea of an act of love involved more energy, bare skin, and sometimes a little seasoning, but fewer ingredients. Just him and her. He ignored the pulse in his groin and opened the window before he started frying the onions. He knew how much she hated coming home to the stink of cooking. He said she smelt food all day at school, so home should be a rest from a constant assault on her senses. Delicate aromas of pear or sweet peas, subtle tastes such as smoked salmon, and most importantly for her ears, silence. He checked his watch and switched off the opera. She was due any time in the next 20 minutes. A fabulous Friday evening. She would enjoy the meal, rejoice at his news, and they'd plan the audition strategy, sitting at the kitchen table. She'd know what pieces to choose, besides the mandatory Haydn, how best to show off his skills. If it weren't for her, he'd still be a mediocre violinist. She had always watched him closely, the first to notice his upper body strength and long, thin fingers. She realized he was better suited to the cello. It has a depth, a melancholy, just like you. You need to spread your legs a little wider. He recalled her mouth splitting into a wicked smile. She was the one who found him the best teacher, an aging virtuoso who had long since refused new apprentices, but who made an exception for her.
Your father was a great friend to me. We can come to an arrangement, he told her, with that simian smile.
Rolf recalled those long afternoons with Jakobiscu with little fondness, if he were honest. The man's revolting face, snapping out criticism and contempt, exacerbated by the scent of mothballs and body odor, made each lesson last an eternity. Yet Rolf's talent had flourished under the old man's tutelage, and although it was impossible to deny his mentor's influence, he was coming into his own. He shook himself. Time to focus on mashed potato. The door slammed shut just as he was uncorking the wine. His nerves fluttered, listening for any sounds to indicate her mood. Keys left in the lock, not flung at the wall. Coat and shoes off inside the door, bag rested on the floor, not dropped from her height. He poured two glasses and waited for her to appear. Leonor stood at the entrance to the kitchen, leaning against the door jamb, her expression quizzical. What's all this? He'd been rehearsing what to say from the moment he put down the phone, but now he just drank her in. Her lean, muscular form, her strong jaw, and that incredible pair of dark brows arching over her hooded eyes. Even when she came home to him every night, even though she had an insatiable need for his body, he still couldn't believe his luck. Leonor von Rosenheim, who could have anyone she wanted, had chosen him. She was smiling as she crossed the kitchen to kiss him hello. Whatever's in that pan is burning, she said, flicking her gaze to the stove. He flipped the chops, turned down the gas, and handed her a glass of wine.
Thank you. After the week I've had, I deserve this. Still, it's the weekend, and it looks like my thoughtful boyfriend has prepared our dinner. Any special reason?
I had a call today, he said, remembering his lines. Her voice dropped as her pupils dilated.
A call? Tell me more.
I'll tell you everything. Sit. We're having pork chops with mash and onion gravy, and a glass of bull's blood. Their eyes locked as they drank, a smile teasing the edges of her mouth. He folded up two pieces of kitchen towel as napkins, splattered a dollop of mash on each plate, added a chop, and poured over the gravy. He closed the window so the draft would not ruin the ambiance, and sat opposite her, failing to suppress his grin. She thanked him for the meal and sliced into the chop.
This is exactly what I needed. The food, the wine, and the good news. Come on, then. You got a call. Don't tease me, she said, looking under her eyelashes.
He swallowed and tried not to get overexcited. The string section leader of an orchestra telephoned. They asked me to audition.
This is my chance, Leonor. This is what we've been waiting for.
She placed her cutlery on the table and clasped her hands to her cheeks, her eyes glowing in the light over the stove.
An audition? So soon? That is the best news. Nazdravi, my love. I'm so happy for you.
Here's to the Windy City. His glass kissed hers, and they drank, holding each other's gaze. Can you believe it? I'll have to rehearse like crazy and choose the right pieces to show what I can do, but we can work on that together. She scooped up some potato and gravy, her expression intense.
Yes, we need to choose carefully. Look at their suggestions and repertoire. Then we rehearse as if our lives depend on it. How long do we have?
He picked up his chop to gnaw the meat from the bone. 3 weeks on Monday. She stopped chewing and took a swallow of wine.
3 weeks? Are they crazy? We won't even be able to get visas in that time.
Visas? Why would I need a visa for Austria? I just have to book a hotel in Salzburg for 2 nights, one before the audition and one after. I suppose that's in case I get a recall.
Seconds ticked past, and she stared at her plate, saying nothing.
He replayed his response, questioning himself. Was he being insensitive? He'd only stated the truth. She resumed eating, flashing him a bright smile.
This pork chop is delicious. Did you make the sauce yourself?
It's not as good as one of yours, I know. But for a kitchen amateur, I was pleased. You know, we could probably afford another ticket if you wanted to come too.
We could. If I used up the money for the gas bill and bought no groceries for 3 weeks, we could stretch to a second seat for me to accompany you. I'll just stay here and defrost the fridge.
They ate in silence until their plates were empty. He racked his brains to think of a way to recover the ambiance, but failed. She spoke first.
If you pass the audition, then what?
When I pass the audition, he gave her a hesitant grin,
then I'll be a cellist with a respected orchestra, and we'll have a bigger, nicer apartment, because there's subsidized accommodation for its members. You can still teach, because Salzburg is full of music students, and I'll work like crazy to be the best cellist they've ever had, and get promoted to principal. We can go up in the world. I mean, back up in the world, in your case. You've sacrificed so much.
He waited for her to lift her gaze from her plate, hoping for the best. You know, they said they'd seen me play at the Bartok competition. Her pride was clear in her smile.
What did I tell you? Even when you sulked all the way home because your quartet didn't win, I said the important thing was to be seen. And you were.
Ha! She reached for his hands, blinking.
Salzburg. I guess that would make a pretty good first step on your career path. Maybe a couple of seasons to establish your name, and then onward to greater things. You can do this. I believe in you. I always have.
We can do this. He squeezed her hands. It's what we've always wanted, no?
A smile spread across her face. She pressed her glass to his lips, but instead of drinking, dipped her tongue into the red wine, lapping like a cat. You are what I've always wanted. Shall we have an early night?
He was out of his chair before she'd put down the glass. After the bells rang midnight, her breathing grew heavier, and he stared at the ceiling, spent. If this hint of success increased his sex appeal to such a degree, God help him if he actually landed a role of a cellist with the Salzburg City Orchestra. He knew nothing about Salzburg, other than the Mozart connection. No idea as to its location or proximity to other Austrian cities, its geography or climate. Her words echoed in his head. An audition. So soon. That is the best news. Nastravi, my love. I am so happy for you. Here's to the windy city. He stretched out an arm to locate his phone on the bedside table, cautious and slow. If she woke for another bout, he wouldn't have the energy. She slept on. He deepened his own breaths, faking a light snore, and typed "The Windy City" into a search engine. The results pointed to Chicago. Chicago? Was that why she mentioned visas? Why on earth would she assume his audition would be in Chicago? He replaced the phone and closed his eyes. Some days, he had no idea how her mind worked. Chapter 2. I shouldn't be here, Rolf thought as he saw him. The conductor came down the aisle of the dining car, checking the other occupants had the correct tickets. When he got to Rolf, he gave him a curious look. He spoke in German.
Where is your guitar?
He asked with a faint smile. Rolf held out his ticket, scrambling for the right words.
Strapped into the luggage rack, for safety.
It's a cello, actually.
Pity! You could have played us a tune.
He scanned Rolf's ticket with his device and wished him a pleasant journey. Only then did Rolf release a long exhalation of relief. He belonged there. Of course he did. The hand-to-mouth existence of the past was behind him. No more ducking and diving, faking and cheating. He was on the way up. He belonged. It would take years, he assumed, before figures of authority ceased to terrify him. Maybe he should, as Leonor had suggested on more than one occasion, seek therapy. Or maybe he should just get over himself. For people like Leonor and her friends, therapy was like having their roots done, or nails manicured. They had nothing to hide. He picked up his knife and fork and continued to eat his Venus schnitzel, commanding himself to focus on the future, not what had gone before. A positive mindset always worked for him. He visualized a successful outcome. Handshakes, smiles, claps on the back. Why not? He knew what he was doing. He and Leonor had chosen selections from his repertoire that demonstrated quality over quantity. They had rehearsed all potential questions, and she had given him critical feedback, boosting his confidence, reassuring him he could reach the moon. He was ready for them. The question should be, were they ready for him? He stifled a smile and opened the small bottle of red wine. If she was here, she would forbid it. Or point out that white suited the dish better. But she wasn't here, and he preferred red. These days, he knew when to stop. A glass, maybe two, with dinner would help him relax. He had the most important audition of his life in the morning, and there was no way he would imperil his performance by drinking too much the night before. The dining car was crowded. Not only with people occupying all the tables. There was a queue for the buffet counter, and the air smelt of frying. Rolf spotted an elderly couple near the door. They both used napkins, and he poured a little bit of wine into the plastic beaker for her to taste. She sniffed it, tasted it, and said something to her companion, who poured a decent measure. Rolf smiled, recognizing the couple's maintenance of their standards, even here. They knew the proper way to do things. That's the problem when you're on the outside. You don't know that you don't know. They do. They know in which order to use their cutlery. They know the correct form of address for dukes, bishops, and the military. How they know such things is a mystery to him. Maybe it's the schools they attend, where you learn an instrument, how to ride a horse, how to speak German with an immaculate Hanoverian accent, how to make small talk and understand the meaning of black tie. He flushed for a second. At least that was an improvement. When he'd first realized that everyone else at the anniversary dinner was dressed in a tuxedo with a black bow tie, and he had simply worn a normal suit accessorized with a black tie, he wanted to leave, lie in the gutter, and die of mortification. Leonor's grace and classy sense of humor rescued him, twisting his social faux pas into an act of rebellion, so that he came out of the event looking cool rather than crass. That could have been the night he told her he loved her. Previous declarations of his admiration had been more along the lines of, God, you're so hot. I can't get enough of you. Or, Has anyone ever told you what a fantastic body you have? Those were the days when it was just the two of them, screwing each other senseless in the hayloft above the stables. Rolf knew disappointment well enough to smother any hopes that this was anything more than a steamy dalliance on her part. He could see the attraction. He may not have read Lady Chatterley's Lover, but he knew the story. She was rich, fit, smart, and experienced. She knew what she liked and taught him how to satisfy a woman. It was like a drug. Yes, exactly like a drug, because he never knew where the next hit was coming from. That all-consuming desperation was a feeling he would never forget, no matter how many years he'd been clean. She could drop him whenever she felt like it, and he would be desolate, craving her body as well as her attention. If it hadn't been for the violin, she probably would have ended the relationship once the excitement of a new sexual partner had worn off. But then, she heard him play. Since the first time she had seduced him one evening after the rest of the estate staff had left, they came to a tacit agreement. He arrived early in the morning and sneaked up into the hayloft. Either she would be waiting on a fur coat, wearing nothing but stockings, or she would climb up the ladder, whispering her intentions. Her voice, the creak of the wooden ladder, and the sound of the horses snickering below, as if they were applauding her audacity, just about drove him crazy. Afterwards, he would work with the other grooms and gardeners the entire day, mucking out stables, oiling saddles, preparing barns and clearing leaves, blossom or snow from the yard, depending on the season. At the end of the working day, he was always the last to leave, dithering and dawdling and finding some reason to stick around. That's when she would materialize with something for him. One time it was a toffee apple, another day it was a silk tie, which they put to immediate use as a blindfold. On one occasion, it was a box of mooncakes, all the way from Singapore's autumn festival, she said. Her father had brought them back that very morning. They crept into the hayloft, fed each other sticky cakes, and gave in to lust. Those dusky moments, as the light faded from the sky, and they each recovered their breath, seemed full of tenderness, in contrast to the sex, which was more like a horse race than an act of love. The horse analogy was about right, as she called him her stallion. She was joking, and he laughed along with her, but a part of him retained that image with pride. Early mornings and exhausting evenings meant he would arrive at his mean little room in a shared flat, eat something, and fall asleep. His violin practice suffered, and when he did pick up his instrument at the weekends, his mind was full of her, and his concentration was shot. Basic pieces he'd been playing since he left school became clumsy and full of errors. He berated himself for allowing an activity he loved to become stiff and amateurish simply because he was obsessed with Leonor von Rosenheim. He risked taking his violin to work, hiding it in the tack room for safety. The ground staff stopped for lunch at 12 to sit at a wooden trestle table in the sunshine, swearing at the weather and arguing about politics. Work resumed at 1 o'clock. Rolf stuffed himself with a sandwich, took his violin from its hiding place, and found a quiet spot in the shade of the barn, far from his colleagues' debates. He had no need of his sheet music, as he was not learning new pieces, but perfecting those in which he was already fluent. He closed his eyes and felt his way along the neck, nestling his chin onto the rest, as if touching his head on a lover's cheek. He raised his bow and launched into his grandmother's favourite, Vivaldi's Spring. His calloused fingers and muscular hands took some time to adjust to the delicacy of the instrument. But as the days passed, he sensed the intuition return, as if he was not simply manipulating some horsehair, wood, and catgut, as if the two of them had become one voice. There were moments while he was lying on his back in the hay, Leonor riding him, when he felt like a violin, coaxed into making sounds of ecstasy. His relationship with his instrument, however, was of a purer nature. What they made together lifted him above the sweat, sex, horseshit, Slovak curses, and the resentment he held for his employers. These people who had far more than they deserved. When he played, all the wealth and beauty of the world were his alone. One day, he finished the Primavera movements and took his chin from its rest, his eyes still closed. A voice, deeper than his violins, broke the silence.
"That was beautiful," said Leonor, leaning against the bar wall. "Why didn't you tell me you played?"
He looked at her face, lit with admiration, and couldn't think of a thing to say. He stroked the warm wood of his violin, confused emotions muddling his brain. His first reaction was anger at being spied upon, tempered by his ego puffing at her words of praise. "I should get back to work." He placed the violin and bow in the case and snapped the clasps shut. "This is my lunch break. I'm not shirking." Her eyes strafed his body with a new hunger.
"You never shirk.
In fact, you go above and beyond the call of duty. You know, my mother has influence in the Bratislava music scene. Maybe she could get you an audition. You certainly have talent. When you finish today, come to the house. We will hear you play more." He wanted to refuse such an imperious command. He badly wanted to say no, to walk away and snub her. She had penetrated every part of him. But his music, that was private. That was his. "What time?" he asked instead.
"When you finish work, as I said. If it works out, we can relocate our trysts to somewhere more comfortable than the hayloft.
Come to the winter garden."
"I'll be waiting."
Rolf finished his dinner and returned to his seat, leaving the older couple just about to begin dessert. He checked his cello was still securely strapped into the luggage compartment and settled down to enjoy the remainder of the journey. He gazed out the window at the rapidly changing landscape and allowed himself a sense of contentment. Austria would be good for them, he was sure of that. For her, it would be an opportunity to regain stature in society. For him, a chance to reinvent himself, discard his past, and become a different person. In many ways, he had already changed beyond recognition, simply by escaping his own shadow, since that warm afternoon in the von Rosenheim winter garden, where he performed like a tame monkey. He had grabbed the chance to climb beyond haylofts and learn to accept not only criticism, but financial support from a mentor. That afternoon, he played for 45 minutes under their unsmiling gaze, after which Marinka von Rosenheim and her daughter discussed him as if he was not in the room. His fingering was muddy, but his understanding of the pieces showed intelligence and musicianship. The instrument was poor quality. That said, the sounds he teased from it showed genuine promise. He would benefit from expert tuition. He had a distinctive talent, and it must be developed. Leonor reached out a hand for his. Confused by this overt display of affection in front of her mother, he extended a hand as if to shake hers. She turned it over, examining his fingertips.
"Look at these hands. There must be no more manual work for this man. We will make him our protégé, and he should attend the conservatoire. But I believe his talent is better suited to the cello, rather than violin. What do you say, Mama?"
Marinka gave him a searching look.
"What is your name, young man?"
"Rudolf Yarrow, otherwise known as Rolf."
"Rudolf Yarrow. Yes, my daughter is right about you.
We will draw up a contract as your benefactors, and you will have the best tutors. Do you play the cello?
At school, I tried most of the string instruments, but found myself most comfortable with the violin.
I don't think... Come with me. I have a cello in the music room. Not the conservatoire, in that case. Leonor, call Jakobiscu and ask him if he is willing to take on a pupil. This way, Rudolf.
And just like that, his life had changed overnight. He exchanged one world for another, and it cost him nothing more than playing his part. For some reason, his spirits slumped, as if the past weighed him down. He shook off the cloud and turned his eyes to the future. He had 2.5 hours before arriving in Salzburg. 2.5 hours to rehearse. This time tomorrow, the whole thing would be over, and he could call Leonor with good news. Yes, that was exactly how things would happen. He carried his cello along to the storage car, filled with crates and bicycles. He set up his camping stool, took out his instrument, and played the opening notes of Joseph Haydn's cello concerto in D major. The first round of the audition was over far too quickly. There was much to improve on, Rolf knew that. But he had made no mistakes, played with passion, and vitally shown no sign of nerves. Of course not. That was his thing. Never in his life had he suffered from stage fright, at least where music was concerned. The principal cellist, a stony-faced Austrian called Sebastian Rahn, asked him to play 2 pieces again, in front of other members of the string section. Dvorak and Schumann. Rolf blocked out the glances between the other cellists and focused on his fingering and bow action. Some of them had questions in English, where his confidence was far less solid. He answered slowly and deliberately, trying to recall Leonor's coaching. One hulking cellist asked about his experience of a chamber quartet, and if so, would Rolf join him, a violinist and a viola player, for a demonstration of his skills? He agreed with enthusiasm, and although the Arensky piece was not part of his usual repertoire, he matched the other's vigour. No one gave any indication of whether they were pleased or disappointed. The concertmaster and another first violinist went into a huddle with Sebastian Rahn, while Rolf sat there like a pudding. Then they thanked Rolf for his time and asked him to return the following day. Rahn did not crack a smile or offer any enthusiasm, but one blonde violinist gave him an enthusiastic nod. Nearly 4 hours after he'd arrived, Rolf left the Konzerthalle with no particular sense of urgency, keeping his steps even and calm until he turned the corner and could be sure he was out of sight. Then he swung his cello case in a wide arc around his body, spinning with joy. He couldn't remember feeling this good since completing his first solo recording for an indie record label. That time, he knew he'd delivered a passionate performance. But even so, he was unprepared for its success. He was the last-minute replacement of a revered cellist who'd been prevented from leaving Russia when trying to board the plane. Some of Leonor's acquaintances were involved in the sponsorship, and they wanted to make the most out of the prepaid studio time. When she learned about the dropout and the repertoire to be recorded, she knew he'd be a good fit. They had huge arguments about what she called unimportant details, but in the end, he signed the papers and found himself in the recording studio with a seasoned quartet, for no pay. Naturally, she was right. What a lesson it had been. And what a success the recording had become, with him on the cover. One of the Salzburg audition panel had even mentioned it today as a musician's favourite. Maybe that was another reason behind his summons. He crossed the road and found a small park, set his case down and checked his watch. Perfect. She would be on her break. As he dialed, he was already smiling.
Rolf, how did it go? I've been biting my nails all morning.
They've asked me back tomorrow.
He pulled the handset away from his ear as she screamed.
There's still another hurdle to jump, but today went even better than I could have expected. All my pieces flowed without a single error, even a Haydn.
She laughed. How come you couldn't do that for me?
Did you meet the maestro? What was he like?
His elation subsided. She had an unerring ability to find the negative side to whatever made him happy.
I didn't see the maestro. Well, I think he popped into the auditorium while I was playing, but the interviews and assessments were carried out by the string section. Neither the principal cellist nor the concertmaster was particularly friendly, but the standard of musicianship is like nothing I've heard. It's such a beautiful city, and the Concerthalle is probably the most incredible building I've ever seen. I already love it here.
Like nothing you've heard?
You should get out more.
Listen, good luck tomorrow. Remember your posture when playing Smetana. Don't forget to meet people's eyes when they ask you a question. And if you do meet the maestro, remember to compliment him on the Children's Opera Initiative. He'll like that. So, if you're finished auditioning, what are your plans for the rest of the day?
He ran his hand over the cello case, as if it were a dog, allowing himself a flourish of confidence.
Exploring our future home? I'm going to check out the apartments the orchestra subsidizes for players, nose around the city center, sample some food, and get another early night. I'll send you some photographs.
No point in doing that until we're sure you've got the job. Anyway, I got a pile of marking to do this evening. Call me tomorrow, yeah?
Of course.
Chastened, he wondered what to say next.
It's strange being here without you.
It's strange being here without you.
Her voice gave no indication of emotion.
Okay. I'll let you get back to work and I'll see you tomorrow.
I wish you were here with me now. We would have so much fun. The fun comes later, Rolf. Use your time wisely. Forget being a tourist. Get back to your hotel room and practice tomorrow's pieces. You've taken the first step, that's all. Congratulations, but keep your eye on the ball. This is our future. Another thing. Don't celebrate your success by drinking wine tonight, because it isn't a success yet. Don't put yourself under the additional pressure of temptation. You've still got a lot of work to do. There's the bell. I have to go.
I know. I'll call you tomorrow. I love you.
She had already gone. He sat there, his phone lying in his lap, staring at blackbirds tugging worms from the grass. Usually he would worry and fret about such a curt end to conversation. Now was not the time. She was right. He had to concentrate. Back to the hotel. Back to his practice. Tomorrow could change their future.
Chapter 3.
His high spirits as they packed up their apartment not only seemed to bypass Leonor, but to irritate her. He toned it down. And after a while, he realized why it was natural for her to be subdued. The only other time she had cleared out a house to relocate was when her family lost the von Rosenheim fortune, and she was forced to downsize from a mansion to a one-bedroom apartment. The act of packing must bring back painful memories. Her endurance and ability to withstand dramatic downward changes in fortune were beyond anything he'd known. He had an urge to emphasize that this move was in the opposite direction. They were going up. Yet even he could recognize their small step on the ladder was nothing compared to the almighty fall when her father's company went into liquidation. His humming, whistling, and non sequiturs such as, "I can't wait to see the new apartment," fizzled into a workmanlike silence as they wrapped their belongings in newspaper and put them into cardboard boxes. A friend of hers,
She always had such useful friends, loaned them a truck to transport their possessions from Bratislava to Salzburg. Those were the kind of favours she would accept, while stubbornly refusing any kind of financial bailout. Rolf once asked her why she kept turning down such generous offers.
"I mean, all they're trying to do is help out a mate. I don't understand." "I don't expect you to."
They locked up their apartment, dropped the key at the renting agent's office, and left Slovakia to cross the border into Austria on a sunny Saturday morning in April. To his surprise, she wanted to drive. His impression of her emotional state made him wonder if that was a good idea, but he said nothing and climbed into the passenger seat. Conversation was limited for the first couple of hours, but as the landscape changed, so did the mood. More than one of his observations elicited more than, and she even offered one comment herself. Without asking him, she pulled in at a service station, and they each bought a sandwich. On the way back to the truck, she said she'd had enough of driving and wanted to eat. It was time for him to take over. 2 hours later, his anticipation reached fever pitch as they parked outside a two-story townhouse with well-kept gardens and a row of neat wheelie bins lining the path, like sentinels in greeting. They left the contents of their old apartment in the truck and went inside to explore their quarters. A shared front door opened into a hallway with a granny flat, laundry rooms, and a door to the cellar. Upstairs was their new home. At least 3 times the size of their tiny little bolt hole in Bratislava. The whole place had been renovated and decorated, and possessed every convenience he could wish for. She seemed impressed, opening doors, testing windows, checking out the view, and testing the water pressure in the shower. "Not bad," she said. "Not bad at all." The orchestra provided basic furniture, such as kitchen appliances, a bed, a sofa, and a dining table and chairs. Within 2 hours, he and Leonor had emptied the truck, dumped the boxes in their respective rooms, and made love on the carpet.
"We should eat something. Why don't we look around the area and find a restaurant? We should celebrate," he said, kissing her shoulder.
Leonor stood up and went to the window at the rear of the apartment.
"There's a garden with a pergola down there. I'm going to have a shower. You go out, get us a takeaway, and we'll eat in the garden. Buy some wine, or better still, champagne. You can afford it now."
He heaved himself up on his elbows, instantly afraid of crossing boundaries.
"I don't know if we have access to the garden. It might belong to the bottom flat."
She turned to him, naked and silhouetted in the French windows to the balcony, her form statuesque.
"Downstairs is just the granny flat. This is the main property. We damn well better have access. Get dressed, I'm hungry. And don't forget the champagne."
He pulled on his underwear and his trousers, eager to spend the first night of their new life eating, drinking, and appreciating their luck. 3 streets away, he found a Thai restaurant offering takeaway packages. He ordered, in passable German, and asked if there was a shop nearby where he could buy wine. The young girl behind the counter was helpful and patient, and assured him he could get to the mini-market and back in the 10 minutes it would take the kitchen to cook their order. 30 minutes or so after he left, he unlocked the front door and ran upstairs, carrying a brown paper bag filled with containers of Thai curry and rice. In his right hand, he held a bottle of champagne. The apartment was empty, so he went onto the balcony to see if she was there. Down in the garden, Leonor was sitting at a wrought iron table, laughing with a young man. Rolf didn't even know how to get into the garden.
"Food is ready,"
he shouted, brandishing the bag. She looked up, and her face broke into a beautiful smile.
"Bring it down here, with plates and glasses. I want you to meet our neighbor."
The guy lifted his face and gave a salute. Hi, my name is Anton. I live downstairs, and I don't want to intrude on your first night. Just wanted to say hello.
Give me a minute.
Rolf collected two plates, two sets of cutlery and two glasses. The gesture was pointed. Tonight, they did not want company. But when he got downstairs and found the door to the garden, he saw Leonor and Anton were already drinking cocktails from martini glasses.
Hi, said Anton, saluting again. Meet Rolf, the one I've been telling you about.
Hello, Anton, said Rolf, forcing a smile.
Leonor took the bag and inhaled.
I love Thai food. Would you like to join us? I'm sure we can stretch this for three.
Anton held up both palms. Thank you, but no. I've already eaten, and I really don't like spicy food. I have a typical Austrian palate, I'm afraid. I'll leave you in peace to enjoy your meal. Oh, just so you know, there's a house cat called Blue. He's currently favoring my place, but changes his mind about where he sleeps quite frequently.
Leonor waggled a glass at Rolf. Are you ever going to open that bottle? That's fine with us. We love animals. Thanks for the martini. Cocktails before champagne. I could get used to Salzburg.
She laughed up at him with the sparkle in her eyes she always used when she wanted to charm someone. Anton laughed with her, evidently spellbound.
Great to meet you. And I'm so pleased to have friendly neighbors again. The last woman was a miserable old bag. Hey, do you two fancy going out for a drink next week? I could show you some local bars and warn you which ones to avoid.
Leonor tilted her face to Rolf, her mouth an O of delight. She was handing him the mic, and he couldn't see a way out.
That's kind of you. It would be useful to learn a bit more about the area.
He twisted the bottle, and the cork popped out. He poured the overflow straight into a wine glass, aware of Leonor's giddy laughter. Anton took his cocktail glasses, wished them a good evening, and went inside his own apartment. There was no sign of any cat. They emptied the cartons onto their plates, drank champagne, and toasted their new start. As the twilight deepened and lights came on in the apartments on the other side of the hedge, their building remained in darkness. Presumably, Anton had gone out for the evening. Why not? Young, not bad-looking, and obviously familiar with the local nightlife. What reason would he have to stay at home? Rolf relaxed a little and let go of the feeling they were being watched. They spent Sunday morning arranging their new apartment to Leonor's liking, ate a simple lunch of tinned goulash, and walked out to enjoy the sunshine. Hand in hand, they strolled the streets, delighting in the blossoms and civic floral displays. Salzburg, in his mind, was clean and white, but his one and only visit had been in the wintry days of February. Now it was a riot of colour, with green buds and grassy parks and flowers everywhere. The wide, muddy Salzach River flowed through the city, much like the Danube through the Slovakian capital, lending a sense of openness and light. Rolf had left Bratislava to come to Salzburg, but the river was headed in the opposite direction. The water rushing past his feet would continue its journey to the Danube, past his hometown, and eventually into the Black Sea. Selfies against the backdrop of the castle, a coffee and pastry, the obligatory visit to Mozart's birthplace, and a pause to listen to a string quartet in one of the many beautiful squares. It was almost too much to take in. Although, as far as the quartet was concerned, he had some doubts about the second violinist's fingering technique. Street performers puzzled him. The casual interest of passers-by was nothing like the breathless attention of a concert hall audience. Rolf was relieved he'd never have to play in the street like a busker. Fine for these music students, of course. It was a way to cut their teeth, but not appropriate for a professional. They only covered a fraction of the old town before Leonor announced her feet were tired and it was time for dinner. Salzburg was nothing new for her, and he had the impression she was underwhelmed. I don't feel like cooking this evening. Let me have one more day of normality before I become a Hausfrau, bargain hunting in the supermarket. You won't have to hunt for bargains anymore. You can buy whatever you like. He was exaggerating. His income would be modest until his probation period was over. If the orchestra hadn't offered subsidized accommodation, their budget would have been barely more than what he used to earn as a jobbing musician. Yes, buy whatever you like. And make exotic feasts for when I get home from work.
How exciting. After all, my whole ambition in life is to cook for a man. That cafe looks pretty. Look, they even have Machfelder Spargel with hollandaise.
His sense of being the breadwinner had made him tactless, and he bit his tongue. Instead of telling her how their lives would change, he should let it happen and watch her pride in him bloom. The white asparagus cheered her up, and she compared Salzburg with other Austrian cities. She'd been all over the country before, naturally, with family or friends, and had seen everything that was worth seeing. Rolf relaxed. They weren't just here for 24 hours. They had months to explore and appreciate this august metropolis. It was their home now, and he was going to make a name for himself. Unless, of course, he got fired in his first week. He shared the thought with Leonor, expecting her to laugh, but her expression darkened.
After uprooting me from the city of my birth and bringing me here as a trailing, not quite spouse, you'd better not.
They walked alongside the banks of the Zalzach, both lost in thought. One of these days, he would learn to think before he spoke. No matter what he said, he had an infallible skill at spoiling the moment.
I won't get fired, I promise you. They think I'm some kind of wunderkind, an image I intend to live up to. I'll work hard, we'll have time to soak up everything the city has to offer, and you will be happy. That is my mission in life, to make you happy.
She caught his arm and turned him to face her, her eyes locked on his.
As missions go, that shouldn't be too difficult.
She grasped his jaw with a firm hand and pulled his face to hers. The kiss, hungry, possessive and demanding, changed the mood. Her pupils dilated, and he took her hand to return to the apartment, already wondering which room she would choose to christen next. Like all new couples, their energy for lovemaking had been inexhaustible in the beginning. Things had changed since moving into that shitty little apartment, working long hours to keep themselves afloat. They were both exhausted, dragged down by the demands of bills, four flights of stairs, intractable bosses, and cold winter months. Things had changed before that, if he was honest, and it was all his fault. Their boundless curiosity for each other's bodies had led to whispers in the dark, voicing their most intimate fantasies. At her encouragement, he told her that the thing which most excited him was also his worst nightmare. So she indulged him. They did it properly, agreeing on a safe word and spending tender moments afterwards coming out of character. During those role plays, she inflicted just enough pain to scare him. That combination of fear, lust, and lack of control drove him crazy. He couldn't get enough of it, and eventually he took it too far. Switching roles didn't interest her, but he wheedled and cajoled until she agreed just once to submit. That's when it all went wrong. He forgot the safe word, and kept going, even after he drew blood and she screamed. Afterwards, there was no tender moment, no reassurance, no sense of trust. She beat the shit out of him, with her fists and feet, and didn't stop, even when he screamed. Rachmaninoff's preludes was the only music he listened to for weeks. Assured the gentle solo piano pieces would not provoke her temper. Even in her fury, she'd been decent enough not to hurt his fingers. Nowadays, sex was on her terms, and only when she was in an exceptional mood did she reach for his restraints. Rolf's fantasies remained where they should have stayed in the first place, in his head. After a while, they started listening to Strauss again, but neither of them ever suggested Also sprach Zarathustra. Chapter 4. That first Monday morning in a new job was always going to be a steep learning curve. Especially for a man who had little experience of regular work in a professional environment. Rolf's colleagues were friendly and curious as to his history. The pretty young violinist from his audition showed him how to use the coffee machine and the trick with the lockers, reassuring him it happened to everyone. She gave him a bright smile and told him her name was Trudy, from Munich. They shook hands. He would have guessed her nationality right away. She had the solid, unshakable air of a practical person who took no nonsense. Her face was striking, with wide-set blue eyes and a full mouth. He found himself watching her as she laughed with her fellow violinists, admiring her easy manner and the shape of her backside in black jeans. The rehearsal room was perfect. It had the kind of acoustics that make him want to sing. And even as he fought the urge to grab his cello and flee, he could not wait to take his place in front of the maestro. On the first day of the season, there were several newcomers, just like him, standing shyly beside their instruments. This would be their first meeting, and nerves made everyone jumpy. Even Rolf, the man who never got stage fright. Jürgen Wilk's reputation was sharply imprinted in Rolf's mind from all the hours he'd spent studying this orchestra, its achievements, and Wilk's reputation around the world. The idea of having such an imposing figure as his new boss was scary and thrilling. But he took his place with humility and smiles amongst his fellow players, channeling the positive, hard-working enthusiasm of a new boy. When Jürgen Wilk walked into the room, everyone stood up. He bowed and nodded a good morning to the entire room, working from left to right. He greeted some individual members by name, welcoming them back from holiday and one from maternity leave. He spoke to each of the new members in turn and took his time moving around the room. It gave Rolf a few nervous moments to assess the man in his natural environment. He was tall and rangy, pacing like a hunter as he moved from one target to another. Dressed entirely in black, he stood out like a musical note on a white background. His hair was blonde and floppy, giving Rolf the impression of a young Andy Warhol. Finally, he stood in front of Rolf, hands clasped in front of his stomach. He repeated the little bow with which he had greeted the entire room.
"Welcome, Herr Jarl. I'm very pleased to make your acquaintance. I have heard very good things, both from the string section and from the recording you have made. I feel quite sure you will be an asset to the Salzburg City Orchestra." His tone was perfectly modulated, and his rhetoric designed to elicit enthusiasm.
"That is a most generous welcome, maestro. I will do all in my power to survive your expectations and prove myself worthwhile to my fellow performers. To assume the position of a cellist with this orchestra is the climax of my life. Thank you."
A smattering of laughter, then applause, followed his little speech, during which he instantly realized he had made more than one glaring error in his English. Wilk gave a faint smile and inclined his head slightly before turning to his lectern. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I would like you to familiarize yourself with your schedule. The season commences this weekend, and we will simultaneously be rehearsing for the grand opening in June. Rehearsals with your sections under your principal.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.